It's sometimes called Lou Gehrig's disease, named after the Yankees baseball player who is the first public figure to suffer from this debilitating condition.
We're talking about ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. It's a rare and rapidly progressive neurodegenerative disease for which there is no known cure.
This month is ALS Awareness Month, and today we meet a patient who's living with the reality of ALS as we hear in his own words what it's like.
It's a Behind the Mystery. Take a look.
Well, when I get out of bed in the morning, the first challenge is how to get from a prone position to an upright position without using my hands or arms, because that's where my weakness is. There are some things that I simply cannot do anymore. It's actually been 3 years that I've been unable to button the sleeve of my right wrist. So I ask for assistance with that. My tea mug is very simply too heavy for me to lift. So my adaptation is I drink it through a straw. The hardest thing for me to know is exactly when I'm going to stop being able to do things. I remember about a year ago identifying what I called the big four, which was the ability to drive, the ability to clean myself, to dress myself, and to feed myself. My name is Stephen Winthrop. I'm 58 years old. I was diagnosed with ALS at the end of 2013.
ALS stands for a very complicated name called amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. We call it ALS, it's less of a mouthful. Historically, it's been called Lou Gehrig's disease. Worldwide, it's often called motor neuron disease. ALS tends to strike you later in life. You've been healthy for, you know, decades. I mean, ALS does get diagnosed with people in their 20s, but historically it's more common to be diagnosed in your 40s or 50s, and symptoms come out of nowhere.
My very first symptoms, they were nearly 6 years ago when I noticed some muscle twitching in my left forearm. No pain, just a twitch that wouldn't seemingly go away. But along the way, I discovered that a lot of the muscles in my left hand and left arm were weaker than the muscles in my right, which is particularly odd because I'm a lefty.
Every story for an ALS patient is different, but they're all tragic outcomes. I mean, this is a relentless disease. Once symptoms start, it doesn't matter if it starts in your hands, your legs, bulbar, it is relentless. It progresses from that point on. And right now, we don't have an effective treatment that slows that process down.
When we first were told definitively by a doctor that I had ALS, I had a pretty good idea that this was coming. The impact on me and my family when we got the news was devastating. My wife and I had two teenage daughters. The toughest day of my life was the day, about 4 days after my diagnosis, when my wife and I sat down with our two kids and told them what ALS was.
My advice for patients to prepare for what's going to happen in ALS is, first of all, to be educated enough to really understand how hard it might be. If they're gonna fight that battle to the end, then be prepared and understand to get ahead of every possible thing, because the earlier you do interventions, the slower the disease is going to progress.
It was within a few weeks of my diagnosis that my wife and I realized that we had to make some changes in our lives, and particularly the space we were living in. There were several features to the house, doors, windows, others that we deliberately designed to help me on my journey. The advice I would give to anybody afflicted by ALS or a similar condition is to think about ease of movement through a space. So we don't have any scatter rugs in the house. All it takes is a quarter of an inch to qualify as a tripping hazard. We don't have any thresholds that somebody could trip over. We have features like handrails on both sides of every stairwell. Many of the doors around the house have a sensor inside the wall. All I have to do is move my shoulder. So the sensors that are inside the walls will activate the motor that opens the door. We've also incorporated a lot of very simple features in the house, having doorknobs that are not knobs but levers. And also all of the outlets in the house are about 15 inches off the ground instead of being way down at shoe level. We wanted a space that would be easy for me to move through without using too much energy.
So the earlier you can think about, you know, how are you going to intervene? How are you going to keep your quality of life up? How are you going to keep your family involved with that? What do your caretakers need to look like? Those are all decisions that people tend to try to make as early as they can to keep their quality of life up and be around with their family as long as they can. A qualified caretaker is an ALS patient's best friend. It's a critical component of your journey with ALS.
The caregivers of people with ALS are the real heroes. My wife, her life has been permanently changed. The position that I'm in at this stage of the disease is that I know that's only going to get harder with time. I do have hope that I will be alive to see the big breakthroughs that are, I think, really some of them just around the bend.
I think patients like Stephen and the entire ALS community should have a lot of hope right now. We know more about this disease today than we did 10 years ago, and the information that we've accumulated in the last 10 years to understand this disease is larger than the previous 100 years of what we understood about ALS. So we are at the ALS Therapy Development Institute in Cambridge, Mass. We have 26,000 square feet of lab space. We're the largest research institute dedicated to finding a treatment and a cure for amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS. And that really has permeated the culture of ALS TDI for since our inception. And we're recognized as the world leaders in the group that really systematically is trying to understand how ALS starts, how the symptoms first appear, how the disease progresses, and how we might develop potential treatments that was going to slow that process down and eventually lead to a cure. And because we understand the disease, we're much more rigorously testing potential treatments that could end up in patients. And I think we're going to start to see the first ones of those very, very soon.
Anybody who's exposed to ALS wants to learn as much as they can about the disease as quickly as they can. The amount of knowledge and information that's out on the internet about ALS, there's more now than there ever has been.
I mean, we have probably one of the most comprehensive websites around called ALS.net. It's a great resource to really understand what's going on in ALS today on a day-to-day basis. My message to patients when they come into the Institute recently after getting such a horrible diagnosis is to make a decision to have hope and battle this disease. It's not going to be an easy journey, but if you're prepared for the journey and if you get in front of those things before they happen, you're going to be a lot more prepared in your quality of life and the impact of your day-to-day life is going to be less. I have a lot of hope that because of what we know now about ALS compared to 10 or 20 years ago with the genetics and the better quality animal models, that we're on the cusp, we're on the horizon of those first disease-modifying treatments, which is very, very exciting.
I believe in the depths of my soul that there are people walking the planet today who are going to see ALS stopped. It's really just a question of when.
No doubt, a story filled with hope and so much important information that anyone can use who is living with ALS.
And for more information on this rare disease, you can visit ALS.net to hear more from others with ALS.
Or go to our website, thebalancingact.com. Stay with us.